can hear me, welcome to this event. I'm very happy to be together with so many great people and so many beautiful souls here in this event. And I want to also use the opportunity to thank you for your hard work and smart work and for all the structures and downlines you built and all the people you told about Healy and make sure they know about Healy, because most of the people on this planet don't even know about Healy. So there is a lot of room to grow, and I really appreciate what you've done so far. Last year I was speaking on this event more about business related topics and statistics and numbers. This year I want to talk about, you can see it here, about synchronicity, which was also a part of my topic last year, and go a little deeper in that, because I think that's an important principle where we can learn a lot from it, and of course, we can use it also in business, because whenever you make a business decision that's not so easy, not so obvious, how do you make a business decision? And your inner wisdom, your intuition, can help you a lot with important decisions that otherwise your mind might be overwhelmed with it. So this can be used not only for health, for wellness, for family topics, for relation topics, but also, of course, for business. And I want to start with the fact that the Healy uses a combination of two innovations, as you know, but in fact, these are really revolutionary, because the first one is the connection of consciousness and matter. And this is a very new innovation that I don't know so many products out there that do that. And I will talk about more on this topic especially, and of course the part with the microcurrent or micromagnetic field and the information, which is also relatively new and at least not widespread. And the combination of those two different technologies makes the Healy so special. And if we look at where do we come from in our worldview in physics, then Isaac Newton, who lived from 1643 till 1727, was kind of the father of the classical physics, and he was viewing the world in a way that everything is separated, like the atoms is the part that is the smallest particle, that everything is separated. That was a great philosophy to develop science, and that made great formulas, great progress. But then the quantum physics came about 200 years later, and it was shown that this idea of everything is separated is not really true, because the quantum physics showed that everything in fact is connected through quantum entanglement and other things. And Max Planck was also a strong believer in this interconnection of everything. By the way, this picture I made with AI, nice tool to make pictures nowadays. You see also this web of all the connections on this jacket. So one step in physics that we might not have really appreciated in our society, in our life, at least not whole humanity. And roughly at the same time, this should be a picture of Carl Jung, psychologist. He discovered this principle of synchronicity. And for you to remember, synchronicity, what is it? It is about two events that are happening at the same time with no causal relation. So for example, a causal relation would be if I drop it, it would fall down, it'd make a sound. That's a causal relation. But two events that doesn't have this relationship, but they are connected through meaning. And those two events are one internal event and one external event. So you have a thought maybe about something, and suddenly in the outside you experience something that's very similar to your thought, with a very low probability that it's happening at the same time. It can be even more than two events, but at least two events. And so that shows there is obviously a connection between consciousness and matter. Because your thought, what you experience in yourself is you are conscious about something, and in the matter you observe there is something that has a high correlation. It gives you an idea, a meaning, a symbolic information. So already that was, long ago, many decades ago, there was the obvious connection between consciousness and matter. So let's go a little further. What does that mean? If there is a connection between consciousness and matter, and obviously there is, and we all, or many of us experienced that already, where would we look for this connection in the physical world? So in the physical world you see the matter, but not the consciousness. But where do you want to look if you want to look for the connection? Well, we have causal processes, like if you drop something, it falls. There is a law of gravity or other laws. When it's a process that's 100% defined by a law, there is not really a room for consciousness in the process. So in the process itself, in the causal process, you will not find it. It's like a machine without consciousness, or at least without what we consider as consciousness, as a human consciousness. And then the next possibility would be to look at causal events, but look at the symbolic meaning of it. So for example, something happens in the outside, you think, oh wow, that reminds me totally on something that I was just thinking about, so there is a coincidence. So those symbolic processes can be a source of those synchronicities. They can happen as they just happen in life, or you can look at astrology or numerology to calculate them. Because the causal process might happen from a more complex relationship of things. And then you have the non-causal or the acausal processes, so the so-called random processes, and there is a chance, if there's a connection between consciousness and matter, that you find it exactly there, in those non-causal processes. And that is exactly what the Healy resonance sensor is doing to query the individual synchronicities. So it's exactly these processes that are used. And as you know, this technology is used since 2007 already successfully by thousands of therapists around the world. So synchronicity shows us the interconnectedness, the deeper interconnectedness between things. So it's a way that the universe communicates with us. So it wants to tell us something. And if you see those signs and recognize them, then it can help you in your spiritual growth, in your development. But this can sometimes have a profound effect. So it's maybe a shift is needed in your observation or decision making or how you think things are. But this has a potential for individual transformation. And so the physical component that you see in the outside in the matter becomes the carrier of a symbol. Very important, it's a carrier of a symbol. But the question is, how do you recognize those synchronicities, those symbols? And also, if you recognize it, how do you understand it? How do you understand the language of the symbol? Because synchronicities may happen in your life, and you might just not realize it. So what can you do? One thing is to learn about the archetypes or the symbolic language, because when the universe is communicating to you in a symbolic language, you can only understand it when you know the symbolic language. If I talk to you in English, you will only understand it if you know about English. If I talk to you in Spanish, you will only understand it if you know about Spanish. And here it's the same. If the universe is communicating to us through symbols, we need to learn about the symbols and the archetypes. What does archetypes mean? In the science, the idea is to go into as much detail as possible and separate as much as possible. But with the archetypes, the idea is you want to keep the wholeness as whole as possible. But to talk about it, to have some distinguishing, you need to have some kind of separation. So the first obvious separation is have two parts, like male, female, like day and night, like light and dark, like in and out. So that's a very simple way of archetype to separate the wholeness in two parts. Not always very practical. So if you divide it in more parts, you have a little more archetypes. But the idea is to have a whole thing that you divide in different parts, but not unlimited, like 10, 20, 100, whatever. But the wholeness should be represented by these parts. And then, how do you know whether it's a synchronicity that's meaningful or not? It's always helpful to think about what's the probability that something happens. Because if something happens all the time, you might think, ah, that's a synchronicity and here and here and here. But look for those situations that are very less likely. For example, when we were traveling we fly over Canada to here, and we were sitting in a plane in Canada, and Jamnam was just texting to a, or speaking to a person. She was on a concert from somebody, and she's also a musician, and she was in contact with a producer. And Jamnam didn't know that. And she was recommending her at the same time, she was just leaving the concert, that she might have to search a good producer and suggested somebody. And the one who she suggested was exactly the person the other artist was just in contact about a few minutes ago. So this is very unlikely. So for this person who received that information in the outside and thinking about, okay, may I do something with this producer, this is amazing and synchronicity. And so probably it's a good idea for her to follow this path to talk with this producer. So this is really an unlikely event. So look for those unlikely situations and then look at the symbolic. What does it mean for you? And the third part is also important because we usually, when we get the information, one part in our brain has immediately a reaction and a judgment. That's very helpful in nature. We need this fast judgment type when we are out hunting or dangerous situation happen, but this part is not the most wisest part in us. So it's a good idea to say, okay, well, that was my first judgment, nice, but don't stick with it. Be open, stay open, and reflect on the messages you get again and again, because the message you get might not be revealed in the first second, sometimes it could, but it might take more reflection. Okay, so these are things you can do in your mind when you know about how to watch what the universe wants to tell you. And the question is, how can we do that with the Healy? Because when the Healy helps us connect consciousness and matter, how can the Healy help us here? Well, for the first part, for the archetypes, this is represented by the databases in the Healy. When you have an analysis of something, you have to choose a database, right? So the database is kind of a representation of archetypes. So when somebody builds a database, it's important that the database is a representation of the wholeness, that all parts of the wholeness are included. And then you interpret the meaning of the results. I will show an example in a few minutes. And then, when you have a database of, let's say, 300 entries, and you get one or two entries out of that, well, the likelihood of one out of 300 is 1 to 300. So it's the probability that it happens, that you get exactly this entry is 1 to 300. So it's already low when you have a database with many entries. So that is a principle that is taken care of in the design of the Healy. And then when you look at the answer, in the beginning, you might think, no, that has nothing to do with me, that's wrong answer, and no. But then when you reflect on it and wait a little bit, you might discover, I can see something in it, there's some truth in it, But it needs some time, so don't judge too fast. Take your time for reflection. What I did about a week ago, when I had most of my presentation already finished, I took my Healy and I chose the database of focus and alignment, because my question was, what topic should I focus on during my lecture in Mexico on the subject of synchronicity, inner wisdom, and healing? Because why not use the tool? Did I cover everything that's needed or not? Or what should I focus more on? And so I did this analysis only once. By the way, that's a way to reduce the probability that something happens. Because if you have a question and you ask like 10 times, 20 times in the search for the answer that fits to you, that's not the way to do it. You have to have a clear intention and do it once. And then respect the results you got. So the answers I got, I want to have 6 answers of this database. And those are the answers I got. So when I get such answers, I look for, is there any answer that's similar to another answer? So it's a like of a confirmation of something. And when I saw, okay, to remove the cover is one answer, and to develop an introspective view, that's a very similar message, so to speak. So that's, and by the way, that's with C, C4, C6, so it's also in the mind. So it's good that we talk about things that happen in our mind, that fits very well. The second group I could see was putting a stop to it, whatever that means, I will explain, balancing adhesion and recognize consequences. By the way, I got the answers in German, I translated it to English. If you search for exactly the same entry, you might not exactly find the same one. I did it with the German database. So putting a stop to it means don't overdo it. Like, okay, look for synchronicities. Use it as a principle or use inner wisdom, but don't shift your life completely. Okay, now I'm just doing that. So you need to keep the balance. You need to see there's a tool in your life that can and is very valuable, but continue with your life. I mean, keep it in balance. Use it, but don't do everything with it. Because recognizing the consequences means, okay, we still have a brain to think. We still need to use it. It's just an additional tool, a very valuable tool, but keep the balance. And about material wealth. Well, as I said in the beginning, you can use it for business decisions. I always used such tools in my business decisions since I started the first business, because there are always some decisions that might be too big for your mind, and then you need something, some other tools. One way to use synchronicity is to use your intuition, because what is your intuition? It's your inner communication with the universe, your inner communication with God, with your super soul, whatever you call it. So then you don't have to wait for a signal outside or need to generate a signal outside. You just do it inside. And the synchronicity is just a situation where something is, the universe is so eager to communicate with you that the synchronicity already happens. But before that happens, you can always tune in and be guided internally by your inner wisdom, by your inner intuition. So I will talk about the 5 steps of inner vision, inner wisdom, if you're interested to learn how to use in your daily life this intuition. First, I want to clarify what I'm talking about, because intuition in different languages, in different meanings, have different characteristics, people understand different things about it. And I made a collection here of different words, different naming of the same thing. You can call it your sixth sense, because we don't have only 5 sense, we have 6 senses. You can also see it as your third eye, which is the sixth chakra here, or the spirit of truth, or your connection to God, or in the Christian tradition, you would call it Holy Spirit, or you can see it as the Guru Vidim, or the Paramatma, or the Super Soul, or just the voice of the heart, or the voice of the silence. So there are many, many names, but that's the topic we are talking about. And now let's compare what we can do with our mind, which is a valuable tool we still should use, and what we can do with our intuition. Our mind is limited by three factors. The first factor is the known information, because we don't know everything we need to know. So sometimes we lack in information, so we cannot make a decision. Then there is, you need to have a decision model, like a law that says, okay, if that happens, then I do this, and so on. So sometimes it's difficult to find a good decision model. And then you need time for thinking. You need analysis time. And that's, by the way, exactly how AI is working now and making very good results. So the known information means big data. So they have a lot of data that our human brain cannot absorb so easily. And decision model, it means the training of the AI. And then the computation power is growing every year because the computers are getting faster and faster. So that's what our mind is doing, is rebuilt by what AI programs are doing. And it's getting better every year. But still it's limited. And it's very good for simple or linear decisions. And you can say it's offline, because when you work in your brain, you don't need to be connected. If it's working on your computer, it works, doesn't need a connection. And with connection, I mean to the universe, to God. And so this is a great tool, and I really recommend to use it. I know in the world, many people just follow something and don't even think about a topic for themselves. So I think there is a need for humanity also to use the mind in that way, in the proper version, but still it's limited. And now, the inner wisdom, which is your connection to God, who knows everything. So you have also unlimited wisdom immediately. There is no time for analysis, just immediately. Wouldn't that be great to have? And you can use it for complex or non-linear decisions, where you don't see what you need to do. And then you go online, you connect to the universe and ask for guidance. So it has a lot of potential and definitely can be used much more. But how can we do that? And when do we use it? For example, when we have problems, we think in a certain frame that we are used to think and work. But major tasks that are obviously go beyond what we know already, this is a situation where you can use intuition. For example, when I started my first business, in the first year, it went not so well. So it was a hedge fund. We planned to have 30% profit for the customers, but we had 10% loss. Not terrible, but not what we expected, not what we wanted. And I thought, okay, what do we need to do to make it successful? And so I asked, okay, my future successful self, who obviously knows what needs to be done, what have you done now that it became successful? So that was the question I had. And then I got some answers from my intuition, and that's what I did and what we did, and then it worked. So you can use it for really difficult decisions. Or you can use it if you just want to change your habits. For example, this year, in February, we plan to go to the beautiful lake Weißensee in Austria, like we did the year before and the year before. But something in me told me, no, maybe not such a good idea this year. And then, intuitively, we were guided, let's go to London and meet some people there, which was much better decision. It was a very blessed time there. Or, if you think small decisions don't matter, think again. Have you heard about the butterfly effect? Connected with this chaos principle. So sometimes, very small decisions can have a huge impact. So it's helpful if you know how to listen to your intuition, to really take it seriously and listen, because sometimes a small thing can make a big difference. For example, about 10 years ago, I was very busy with my restaurant and hotel and doing a lot of management there. And then a friend told me, well, I'm going to meet this and this person. Would you like to join? And I said, My mind said, I'm too busy, I don't have time. But somehow in my heart I felt, this feels good. I don't know why, but this feels good. I'm in peace and in harmony with this idea. And so I took the time, I visited his friend. And during the conversation, I became very important ideas because of what the other person did in their business. And then I had an idea, and this idea led me to finding my business partner for Tian Restaurant and Tian Bistro, which I'm together with in this business still and very happy about it. So, and that brought relief on my time schedule because I was too busy, because it took over many things. So sometimes a small message can be very important and make a big difference. But what happens usually in our daily life? What is preventing us from using our intuition that we all have? We just need to uncover it. Usually there is this way how the things are now. And then there is our everyday life, which some expectations, imaginations, and there is a gap between, because reality is not always exactly as we would like to have it. So this causes an internal unrest, and then the loudest voice in us that is crying the loudest and promising some solutions is the one that gets heard. And then we continue in our old pattern, because this voice is not the inner wisdom. So what we need is a pattern change. And the idea about intuition, how can you use it more in your daily life? I broke it down in 5 steps. The first is, and it's in blue, like water, you take it in. It's accept the situation as it is. I will go to each point in a minute in detail. The second is, you become active, you ask a question. That's where your mind can become active and do something. And then again, blue, you listen. You listen to your intuition and pay attention to synchronicities and have an inner dialogue to marry your mind and your intuition. And then, final step, you react. You act according to your intuition. So it's basically 5 steps that you can memorize easily with your 5 fingers. And the first step is accept the situation. Why does that matter? Because when you think you already know, then you're not humble, and then you're not open. So by accepting the situation as it is now, maybe there's a lot of wisdom already in that. So by accepting the situation, you accept the wisdom that's in the situation. And you maintain this, oh, maybe, where is the wonder? Where is this surprise? And letting go of your expectations frees you also and keeps your inner peace, because you need the inner peace for the third step, for listening. And when you go a step further after accepting, you are even grateful for the situation, what the situation is now, then your peace gets stronger. And one step ahead is you love the situation as it is now, because then you are totally in peace with the here and now. And if you don't find your inner peace easily, just accept that you don't find your inner peace easily. And by accepting that, your inner peace increases. Just accept what it is. So it's like the like symbol. Very easy to remember. You just like it as it is. Not always so easy, but keep in mind, we don't know maybe already fully what things are meaning. And maybe there is even a blessing in the situation that you don't understand yet. So try to view it in a very positive way and accept it. Then the second step, as I said, your mind can become active now. Asking a question with your mind is like directing your finger to something. Okay, what am I interested in? And what's the focus of my interest? Because how can the universe help you, and the universe respects your free will, if you don't have a clear will what you want? So you have to focus and write down. Where do you want to go? And writing down brings also more clarity. There are many questions you can write down. One simple question is, where do I stand in my own way now? Or what's just the next step? You don't have to understand everything at once, just what is the next step that's fitting. And the more desire you have for an answer, the better it works. And this applies also when you write a focus text for a Healy analysis. Take this step serious, and the analysis results will more likely blow you away in a positive way. So think out of the box. Also ask big questions, not just simple, but also think really big. And of course, business questions can be asked as well. It's your internal guide. The universe can guide you in every area, of course, also in business. Then the third step, so you listen now and pay attention to synchronicities. So with the first step, you already come down peacefully, and now you pay attention to the messages that are coming with this feeling of peace and knowing. You just know, yeah, that's the right answer. The sixth sense is the sense of knowing. You just know it. You don't have maybe an explanation. You just know it's true, and it feels peaceful. That's how you detect it. So it's not the voice that says, yeah, you have to do this because... No, that's not the inner wisdom. That's your mind and your fears maybe. But the inner wisdom comes with peace. And so true openness to the answer is helpful. Because if you have an answer, you think, oh, I already know the answer. You are not open. And you can listen in silence or with nice spiritual music, whatever you prefer, what helps you in your listening process. And the messages can come on all kinds of levels, whether your thoughts, some ideas, some pictures, some feelings, whatever. Synchronicity can come in many forms. A person talking to you suddenly talks about the answer you were just thinking about the question. And so you pay attention to all those synchronous little things that are happening inside and outside. And sometimes the first impulse is already the intuition. So you are peacefully, you think about something, and then, yeah, that's, I know it already, that's it. And it's going in the middle, so inside, you go inside yourself, it's the middle finger, and increase your sensitivity for these quite small messages, and over time it will get clearer and clearer. But then when you got an answer, what does your mind do? He says, yeah, but there is a question. So to get a clear and deep recognition, you have to have a dialogue between your mind and your intuition. So it's basically you accept the answer you got and ask your additional question. And then you listen again. And that together is the inner dialogue. So accept, ask again, and listen. And you do this as long as necessary until you, it's the marriage finger, until you married your mind with your intuition as much as possible. Because when the mind is also on your side of the intuition, then it's easy to execute. Otherwise, you will always get a but and the fear and whatever it is. So combining intuition and understanding is basically the essence of the fourth step. And then the final step, the small finger, is small but important. Because if you do something, if a friend recommends you something, and you don't do it, and then you ask again your friend, you don't do it, you ask again your friend, you don't do it, at some point your friend will stop giving you advice. So you need to take the answers you got to your questions also seriously, and act also to it. And if it's a big decision and you're not sure yet, start practicing with smaller decisions, where the risk is low and you can afford to be guided by your intuition and nothing bad goes wrong. And that step to act according to your advice usually changes the situation. So even if you accepted it at the first place, it might not stay like that. That's an important concept to remember, because if you think, for example, I was in Bali talking to somebody about this concept many years ago, and he said, accepting, yes, that's my life philosophy. And then he was surprised that there is something else, that there's a second step, and a third, and a fourth, and a fifth. So accepting is a good start, but through your wisdom that you get and through the actions you do, the situation might change, and that's okay too. And sometimes there are difficulties when you act according to your intuition, to inner wisdom. Other people might say, ah, you are crazy, this doesn't never work, and whatever. So you get some resistance from the outside, or even your own doubt might come. That's totally natural, that happens. So don't be afraid if this happens. This is just part of the process. If you're not sure whether it was really the answer you needed, then ask again. Ask again till you are having this feeling of peace and wisdom that you know that's the right thing to do. And this answer can be a small step in a bigger process with a bigger impact. So observe the results from what you do, because sometimes I experienced, okay, I got the intuitive information, but I didn't do it. And then later I saw, why didn't I take this book for this person? Because I thought, why should I take this book now? And then I realized, oh, it would be so nice if I now would have this book for this person. I knew it. So observe what happens if you follow your intuition or if you don't follow. You have the choice. But observe what's the difference. Okay, easy to remember, 5 steps. And okay. I have something for you at the end where this is also on it. Don't worry. So, would you like to practice a little bit on that? Okay. Okay. One way of starting with this is to exactly take those topics where you have difficulties with, because there you might need some wisdom, right? So when you're really open to new changes and attitude adjustments and new wisdom, then take those situations where you have difficulties, feel some unrest, unhappiness, and try to accept the situation as much as possible. And now what I would like to do together with you is the second step, which you can always use when you write a focus text for the Healy, is what's the question? So what question would you like to get answered? Because if you have some unrest in you, what exactly is the question that is connected with that? The question might be whatever, very individual, different. And what is the really important question? And ask yourself, if you have already written down a question, is it really the most relevant question for that topic? So use your mind to think about what's the right question and write it down. And that's where I now invite you to write it down either on your mobile phone or in a paper or in a book. If you have some topic in your life where you think, okay, this is a topic where I need higher guidance, where I need intuition, write down what is your question. Because writing it down is also a commitment, and it brings more clarity. Because when you wrote it down and you look at it and you see, okay, well, yeah, that's really my question, true, or maybe I changed the question a little bit. So by writing it down, you start the interactive process of reflecting, okay, is this really the question that's very important for me? If you don't have a question, you can always ask, okay, please teach me about peace, or whatever important topic you have. And then what supports the process is the why are you asking these questions? Because when you have a strong desire for an answer, it will work better. So write your question and write also why would you like to get this question answered. And if you like it for yourself, that's fine. But if you have a why that includes also other people, maybe your family, your friends, your business partner, your community, the city you live, the country you live, the planet, the whatever, the animals, the plants. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. So if you connect to a higher purpose, then it gets even more power. Because how do you encourage the universe or God to communicate with you? I mean, he or she is always communicating with us anyhow, we just don't realize it most of the time. But it's basically, how can we be more open to it if we see the higher sense, the meaning, the purpose in it, then we are more open, because then we see, okay, it's for me it's good, it's for my family good, for my friends, for my partner, for the whole world, for the business, it's so good, I really would appreciate if I get an answer to that question. That makes the question more powerful. So does everybody have a question now written down? Okay, I hope so. Because then, this is a process where you need your mind, you need thinking, reflecting, and as the saying goes, God helps those who help themselves. So this is a process where you can do a lot active, second step. But now, when it comes to listening, how do we do that? For example, when Jesus Christ brought the Holy Spirit to his disciples after he was dying, he brought it with the words, "Peace be with you." Peace. So it's about peace. You need to find inner peace to be able to listen and to receive this connection. So it's nothing new. That's 2,000 years ago. Everybody who could listen, it's there, nothing new, but it's on us to apply it. Or as Gandhi said, not so long ago, the only tyrant I accept, and as you know, he was for peace, in this world is the still small voice within. So it's about this inner connection that you already have. So how do we move into this state of consciousness and feel this inner peace and connected? One way is to be alone in a quiet, undisturbed room. Maybe listen to some spiritual music, or just be quiet, or be in nature. So just be undisturbed as much as possible, that helps. Doesn't mean it doesn't work online all the time, but this is a good way to start and learn. And sit comfortable so that the body does not disturb you in any way. Or lay down, whatever is comfortable. And then breathing can also help. Did you realize when you breathe deep and fast, it gives you a lot of energy? And when you breathe deep and slow, you calm down. And if you combine those two principles into one breathing exercise, could look like that. So you breathe in. By the way, through the nose is better. Breathing in and out through the nose, generally. You breathe in and count till four. Then you hold your breath, count till four. And then you exhale and count till eight, or two times till four. So the exhalation process is longer than the inhalation. And so you get the energy, but you also get the peace. Because you don't want to sleep when you do this kind of meditation, and you don't want to be too active. So this breathing can help you balance that out. Would you like to try it? Good. So one way to breathe in deep is to breathe into your belly first, and then into your chest. So you can also feel it with your hand maybe. So you breathe through your nose into your belly, and then into your chest. And then you hold your breath, counting till four, and then you exhale slowly, slowly, counting till eight. So let's do it like three times. Breathe in, one, two, three, four. Keep, one, two, three, four. And exhale, one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. Once again, deep in, inhale, one, two, three, four. Hold the breath. And exhale slowly. And one last time. Deep inhale, keep the breath. One, two, three, four. And then exhale slowly, slowly, slowly. If I do that 3 times, I already feel more clarity and peace in myself. Maybe you have a similar experience. If you practice this, you can also do it a little longer, but just through breathing, you can help yourself coming into this peaceful state. And then, when you are in this peaceful state, you close your eyes and observe your body and relax, see where there's tension, relax more, come into more body peacefulness, and observe your thoughts and let them just pass. And the goal is to come to a state of inner peace. And then you ask a question. And I would like to invite you, we play 2 minutes music from now, to just go into an inner peace and think about the question you wrote down before and see what answers are coming. Technique, please, the music. So if you do that alone, at home, in nature, you can continue to do that as long as needed. But now, since we have a limited time frame, we have to continue. And then when you got your answer and had the inner dialogue, and you know, okay, that's the right answer, you just carry out, you just do and act according to the advice. For all of those who are not feeling they get a lot of information or pictures or thoughts or answers, I have one encouragement. Look at the starry sky during day. What do you see? The sun. Because the sun is so bright, you don't see any stars. The sun is a symbol for our mind, our thoughts that are always ongoing. But if you look at the starry sky during a solar eclipse, you suddenly see the stars. They were always there. You just couldn't see them because the sun, your mind, was so active that you didn't realize all these messages of the silence. And if you look at the sky during night, then you see even more. And then, if you have a Hubble telescope and look into the sky in the universe, there is even more to discover. So, you have to start somewhere, but when you do this process, like everything, when you practice, it gets better and better and better, and you will be able to distinguish between, and you get information, because it's always there. It's always there. We just need to be quiet enough and ask. Some traditional ideas that can also help for better listening is fasting. Some people report when they do fasting, like with water and tea, they have much more inner clarity, intuition. Also helpful, drink no alcohol or eat a fresh vegetarian diet. Then drink enough water, especially outside of the meal times. Ayurveda confirms that, not during the meal time, but between. And have enough fresh air. Go out, breathe the fresh air, and do exercise and yoga that can also support this inner balance, and have enough sleep. Sometimes you also wake up, or in the middle of the night you have a dream, and the answer appears in your dream. And you can take a cold shower in the morning, gets you rid of negative energies and makes you fresh and awake. These are all small steps that you can do that are well known, as I said, traditionally. You can maybe chant your favorite mantra, either loud or singing it together with others, or just chant it in your mind. That's what I mean with microdose mental chanting. So just chant the mantra in your mind. Or you listen to some uplifting spiritual music. Or you can also carry some affirmations. Like one of the affirmations I used a lot over many, many years is, the infinite wisdom of God guides me in all my ways. Just repeat that again and again. And you have to also feel it and believe it so that it works. And it's like it's in the here and now. It's not in the future. You formulate it in the here and now. Like, thank you, God or universe, for your guidance. Thank you means you already have it. You already have it. It's not thank you, you will give it to me. No, thank you that you gave it already to me. It's already here. And be grateful that you're already being guided wisely. It's already here. And then ask for the positive side and blessings of a situation. Because if you look at the positive side, you are more open to guidance because your judgment is a little on the side. You can also use incense sticks or aroma oils, whatever helps you uplift and increases your peace. And then, of course, you can use your Healy. So we have five different states here, basically, that you can support individually with different Healy programs. So here's a selection of some programs that I like to use. For example, this combination of care and release I used several times when I was in emotional unrest for some situation that wasn't working or going so well, and I felt some still emotional disbalance. I run the care program, and after that, the release. That really made wonders for me, so to speak. I felt so much more in peace after that. And yeah, as you can see, there are different programs. For example, for the question, it's good to activate the throat chakra because you need your thinking process or the concentration. And for the third and fourth step, I would choose the same programs because it's very similar. You listen and then immediately you have the inner dialogue, so it's a similar process. And then when you want to do something in your life, you might need some energy to do that, or you might need some self-confidence or whatever helps you to support you acting out the advice you got. And so what I tried to do today is to make aware of the three ways of communication we have with the universe or with God. The first one is the synchronicities that are already there. So the universe already wants to communicate with you. It's on us to listen, to see and recognize those synchronicities. Then the second is, we kind of actively from our side, with a question, with a clear intention, start the communication to the universe by intending to generate a synchronicity. Either you pick a wisdom card or you use the Healy with different analysis modules, or in the future, very soon, as Christian yesterday said, we'll have the business suite where you have a database with entries that are especially designed for business needs. So when you have a business question, that would be a perfect database to get fitting answers. And then third, you can use your intuition. You just use what you got from the universe and use these five steps for inner wisdom. to have a direct communication already internally before anything happens in the outside, maybe. And as I said, practice, just repeating, doing it makes you more perfect. And at the end, I have two presents for you. One is this card. It's like a playing card. It's a joker card. And on the joker card, you have the five steps to inner wisdom on the backside. So you can always carry it with you, just to remember when the game of life is too tough and you need a joker, you have the joker with you. It's your inner wisdom. And finally, if you want to listen to more nice spiritual music, I made a playlist on YouTube. Here is the QR code to it to go directly to the playlist. It's more than 150 songs, spiritual songs, that I personally like and have very positive, uplifting effect. You can also play them while you're cleaning up at home or especially when you want to communicate with your inner wisdom. So, thank you very much.